Look at you.
Hello, how's it going?
So, welcome to EVE Fanfest 2011. It's been quite a show already, but I hope we have saved something of interest to play out now for you. I want to welcome you all to Iceland on behalf of Iceland. I knew I introduced this concept last year about moving it around to have better weather. How did we do on that? Okay. And that's with Iceland, you really can never know. So, as the line goes, if you don't like the weather in Iceland, just wait 5 minutes. At least there wasn't a volcano, so. There's always that. So there's been quite a new things this FanFest around. We have these amazing leather jackets in the EVE store, and they're quite luxurious and expensive, $500 each. And we were sort of testing what are people really interested in. And I guess people are interested in that because we have sold 12 already, and they are then custom ordered and shipped to people. And the tattoos. We sort of had the idea of, okay, let's have a tattoo booth. Maybe someone gets a tattoo. It's over 20 people already that have gotten a tattoo. There's even CCP people that are getting CCP tattoos. And this is Ryan O'Neill, who has been with us for quite a while. He actually is leaving CCP to found a company in China. Has mad plans for world domination. I don't know where he got that idea. But he's getting a CCP tattoo on his last day. That just makes me think we're doing something right. And of course, there's been a lot of interesting presentations already by some seriously smart people that also look it. There's been live agents, there's been a whole panel on women and EVE. These are all female EVE players who violently do not want to change the game, which was kind of interesting. And of course, the magical chess boxing. Which is sort of, okay, let's do chess boxing. And I immediately sort of had the idea in my mind, okay, CCP doing chess boxing, what will that look like? Well, it looks sort of like this. Those guys were not kidding. I mean, that was hardcore. And congratulations to Piosi. I met him just in the lobby prior, and he sort of pulling through on very strong painkillers. He's a bit of a mess, frankly. And he's kind of key in getting Karna out. But I heard that Benjamin Bong, gave him instructions to Danny about not injuring his head or his hand so he could finish in Karna. And pub crawl. Not a lot of enthusiasm for that. What? Are you still too hungover? I got some more pictures. I'm not going to show them to protect the innocent. And new, this time around, we have a live stream going on, which is going on right now. Hello, people on the internet. We had up to 6,000 views when the chess boxing was going on. So that is quite a big by internet standards, according to Level 3, who are helping us do this. So peak concurrency, we try to break all records. And the broadcast has had this amazing quality to it. I really don't fully understand how people who are really sort of just learning this as they go along, even though they, of course, EVE TV has been around, but still, this is something that people have just learned at CCP, and the level of polish and production quality on this is going to be quite mind-boggling. It's this guy, Oliver, who really keeps the show going. Here you see the live production booth. We should all say hi to Oliver. He's watching this. And there are some sort of things I wanted to bring attention to. We have, for the past sort of ever since really EVE went live, we've been doing these collections for both Child's Play, Gamers for Good, and Plex for Good, which is now a sort of program which we have been running for a while. And we're now over $100,000, which all you guys have given to people in need around the world. So you should all applaud yourselves. Of course, the impression the world has of EVE players is a little bit like this. It's the people in the sandbox that hate sandcastles. They do it in all languages. But really, I mean, you guys have are obviously soft at heart, given how phenomenal this program has been going. We're also going to announce the Council of Stellar Management elections now. And I want to start by thanking the current Council of Stellar Management for really hard work, so hard that people are not continuing because it's too much work. And I want to give them all an applause. I would say overall, this whole concept has gained a lot of sort of momentum and also sort of improvement in how the CSM and CCP work together. Both parties are learning, but I would say, based on sort of what was going on last year, that the overall concept works. It's really good to have people really point out when we are not standing true to our commitments and when we should just harden the fuck up and be more true to that. There's record turnout, which I also think has to do with the fact that the CSM has really just gained in importance. There could be other people having other views on the vote turnout. I was just taking a look at who won, who's the current chairman of the CSM, and it's someone really famous. No. This is it. This is the new Council of Stellar Management. And I have to say, knowing some of these people, either directly or indirectly through the internet, I have to say this is going to be some Council of Stellar Management. It's going to be interesting. Of course, there's been a lot of talk about the notion of stakeholders and the status of CSM. Of course, here at FanFest, we have all the stakeholders around EVE Online, of which there are really a lot of people that have both helped us to get here and done a lot of sacrifices to get to where we are. So having this representation from the player base around the table when we make decisions, I genuinely believe that will help us make better decisions. It certainly will not mean that we will just do what the CSM tells us, no more than we do what any one of the stakeholder group tells us to do. It's always finding the best solution that is not a compromise, but something that meets all constituencies. And it's also what we think more and more about these days are the new players, are the players which are not currently playing EVE Online. Because if we are to continue this on for decades, we have to continue to find new players, and some of them are really young. This is actually a son I'm having in 3 weeks. My wife is watching the live stream. She couldn't make it here. She is getting quite fed up with the release schedule. really hopes this is coming out on time. Here's a little peek into CCP as we do each FanFest. Here I've taken some of the sort of key metrics we've shown each FanFest around. As you see, it's we continue the story. The company continues to grow along the pace we've been growing the past years. We're now over 600 employees, so that has been quite a dramatic shift for CCP to get to this number. We've been running a lot of recruiting around the world, and we've gotten amazing people to join us on top of the amazing people we already have. So as we now get more and more sort of integrated and people know each other and learn how to do things the CCP way, we will continue to see more momentum on the things which we have been developing. And it's really important to us not to turn into this when we grow. Bigger is not always better. So we spent a lot of time at the company to help explain what CCP is doing, because what CCP is doing is a little bit different than what companies usually do. And we have these things which we call kickoffs, where we each year sort of set a theme which is then going to resonate throughout the next 12 months. And we started this back in 2004 when we were getting out Exodus, or Siva as it was called. It was actually then when the Soon TM notion got started. And then we really focused on, sort of in September 2004, on just saying no to features and just getting the damn thing out. And of course, we talked about, at last FanFest, we talked about the focus on excellence we sort of put in motion back in 2009. And I was really glad when I saw threads like this on the forums where people were referencing that, okay, CCP said we were going to focus on excellence, and then you call bullshit on us when we are not doing it. That really helps us sort of being honest and keeping with what we're doing. And the theme which we sort of kicked off with August last year is this one. So we are now going to focus on our ability to deliver more than ever before. And of course, as the company has grown, as we have grown, we're doing a lot of things, then our ability to deliver on things has gone down. But we are now really have a focus on that. And I think you have started to notice some of that. I mean, the things that BFF has been doing, the fact that we have the character creator out, the fact that we're releasing Incarna in steps is all done to just focus on delivering and being faster at delivering. Because there is a problem with excellence. When you put too much focus on excellence, then you just tend to take way too long. Like, excellence can just go on forever. And as they say about the 11-month baby, it really doesn't get any better, even if it takes 11 months. And this my wife would violently agree with. Release things when you mean to release them. I'm actually turning into a little bit sort of compassion pregnancy here. So I am going to go on the Scott 5000 program now when I'm on my paternity leave. And for those that missed the dev beer quiz.
Gandhi, Jesus, Muhammad, Moses, the Dalai Lama, Simmons, Norris, Ferrigno, Blanks, DJ Fonda. I'm not saying Scott is a spiritual leader of the next fitness generation. I'm just saying, he's transformed me inside and out, touched my very soul, and this body, the temple I worship at every day, thanks to Scott 5000X.
I was blown away when I reached Bay 30. None of this was here prior to the program.
It's about bringing it. It's about intensity. It's about finding out who you are, and it's about getting into the best shape of your life. It's simple. Just 3 shots a day with a special Scott 5000X formula, which has been approved by a doctor. And 15-minute workout routine that includes extreme yoga and ab ripping will give you incredible results in just 30 days.
Yeah, the Scott program is going to take me here. It's now called 600. So you remember when we first saw this, CCP was 300, now we're 600. So speaking about delivering and delivering excellence and hard things, then hardware, we've been doing a lot of things on the hardware front. We're in very tight collaboration with IBM, who's been helping us a lot by inventing just base age technology to be able to make this game run. And we've both done a massive upgrade to Tranquility itself on the node basis. And we just completed a massive hardware upgrade for the database where we did a massive disk array. And you probably have seen Derek talk to that in a lot of detail. This is actually what TQ used to look like. And the reason why we've never shown any pictures is because you won't really show pictures of this. This is what it looks like today. Or when our marketing department has gotten our hands on it, this is what it looks like. So it's black, which makes it faster, as we all know. And speaking of hardware, it really, we've always been this interesting mixture of hardware and software. We really have always found ways to leverage the sort of most cutting edge hardware we found around, whether that has been on the back end through with IBM, but also on the front end, with the companies which really enable us to do amazing things on the client. Then I want to get on stage here, Tony Tamasi from NVIDIA, who really has been helping us to get or realize the vision for Incarna. So Tony, I guess you have been to quite a few of these.
Yeah.
What do you think of this one?
Nothing quite like this.
Yeah.
I think, in fact, the pub crawl last night caused so much lag in one of our people that he actually missed his flight this morning. So, if there's you can say a lot of things about the EVE community, but they definitely know how to have fun. It was awesome. Yeah. I'm still lagging a bit myself, I think.
Yeah. So. It has always been, like ever since, I remember since I was programming back on the Riva 128 decades ago, It's always been this like, okay, NVIDIA comes up with new things, and then we find ways to springboard off it.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, like, will you ever be deliver us hardware where it will be done? Will we ever solve this problem?
Well, we hope not. We worry sometimes that it might happen, and we'll get a new generation of hardware out, and we're all excited because it has all sorts of new features. And then we're like, ah, geez, no one's using it. And then you guys will cook up something that just we never even dreamt of. And not only does it, you know, blow our minds from a technology or visuals perspective, but then we realize, holy crap, we're not even close to done. We've got so much more to do. And that's the cool thing about working with CCP is they have this amazing vision, and then they have this ability to translate that vision into technology, and then the technology is fun. And there's this wonderful cycle of technology advances, the game gets better, the visuals get better, NVIDIA needs to make better hardware, and then this loop continues. It's a great partnership.
Yeah, it has been quite amazing. So, I mean, you have quite a number of interesting things coming up, but I was looking at the roadmap and like, what are we telling, the factor of 100 in what, 7 years?
7, 8 years, yeah. So this is our desktop GPU roadmap. And one of the things that the GPU business tries to do is run well ahead of what's called Moore's Law, which is just kind of how many transistors you get. And so what we have here, in the space of 7 or 8 years, we're going to get about 100x increase in performance. That's two orders of magnitude. So, you know, I can dream about all sorts of amazing things that are just at the cusp of maybe possible, but in just a couple of years are going to be just commonplace. And we just really want to continue pushing the envelope. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I was really surprised when I was looking at your slides. I mean, on the mobile side, I mean this is quite a growth there. Are we talking about that we would be playing, I mean, Incarna as it stands now, a few years from now, just on a mobile device, or
you tell me. I hope so.
Okay.
So we're really at the launching point, I think, for mobile technology. So we just launched our first mobile product, Tegra 2. There's some devices that are shipping actually in the world today, and that's our first kind of real stab at a mobile graphics processor. And since we're kind of early in that curve, in the space of, you know, 4 or 5 years, we're going to get about 100x increase in mobile capability. And to maybe put that in a little bit of context, in a couple of years, on a mobile device, and by mobile I mean a tablet or a phone, you're going to have the same horsepower or potentially more horsepower than your desktop PC has today. So if your desktop PC can run EVE today, then I can imagine, you know, a phone or a tablet running EVE and Incarna and maybe World of Darkness mm-hmm. in the future.
I mean, speaking of PCs today running things, we of course have been making Incarna, and we've been making a lot of improvements to our engine.
Yeah.
And as a result, we've had to deprecate Sierra Model 2 and some of the right. sort of technologies which are getting outdated, yeah. both to have the agility to move on, but also it's just, frankly, some of these things
sure.
cannot be ported
sure.
back.
Right.
And I mean, we've been doing things together on the promotion side.
Yeah.
Is there anything more we could be doing to help people with that?
Yeah, I think there's probably a couple of things. One of the things that we're doing is we're working with one of our partners, EVGA, such that all EVE players in the next day or so are going to be getting an email so they can get a discount on NVIDIA graphics card just because you're an EVE player and because we think you guys are awesome. But you know, since we're here and you guys are here, I'm guessing we wanted to do something more. And so I was sitting in the EVE keynote yesterday, and we were talking about PvP and lag, and there was a little reference to, you know, stabbing, you know, the guy next to you with a knife, kind of like a big fleet battle. And some people reached under their seat looking for the knife, and they didn't find it. But I think if you look under your seats, a couple of you may actually find a knife. And if you actually happen to be one of those people that find a knife, if you come up after the keynote, we're going to give you a GTX 560, which is a pretty much our latest, greatest generation graphics card. So there's a few in the audience that will hopefully get a lucky card.
And I will just say, if there are any CCP employees that are finding a knife under the seat, please pass it down to your left, but don't stab anyone.
No stabbing. Yeah.
This is for EVE players. We have good enough to have hardware at the office. Well, yeah. That's quite amazing.
It's been a wonderful partnership, by the way. I mean, I can't think of many other companies that push technology in such an innovative way and drive NVIDIA to keep pushing technology to make the game just a great place to be. So.
Yeah, it's been quite amazing. I mean, yeah. Thanks so much for coming.
Thank you very much. It's great. Thanks, everybody.
So a lot of all these innovations, both on the hardware side and also, both on the cluster side and also on the client side, rest on this platform, which we have been building for a while, and we've usually referred to it as the CCP Core Technology Platform, and I've been explaining this concept for a few FanFests now. But last year, we decided to give it a name, because there is this old Icelandic saying that if you know its name, you can kill it. Which is about magic and power and what names used to mean. And it's really important, if something doesn't have a name, then it really doesn't have an identity. So we went through the process of giving it a name and sort of really starting to talk about it as Carbon. And some people took it a little bit too far.
But are you sure this will work?
Yeah, don't worry. Just get the stuff ready
And remember, when I stand up, that's your cue to enter. Hey,
Haldor. How's it going?
Not bad, not bad. Do you mind if I come in? How's that Fanfest coming along?
It's coming along great. This will be our best Fanfest ever.
Wouldn't you then say that carbon is an intellectual property, like Eve or dust?
Sure.
Then wouldn't you agree that carbon deserves its own Fanfest?
And this concludes the presentation. It's been great to have you all for this first Carbon Fanfest.
Yeah, on slide 33, point 2, sub item 3, in the formula you used, you had n squared, but I believe it should be n cubed.
I beg to differ. Using the Heisenberg principle and using a corollary, we can show that any power of n will be wrong.
Haldur, are you sure this is a good idea? I mean, what type of fanfest would this even be? What would be the theme?
Well, actually, we have been giving this a lot of thought.
We?
Yes, you see, the gang and I have been coming up with all sorts of ideas for the Carbon Fest. For example, to tie this all together and create a really exciting theme, we have created Captain Carbon.
Captain Carbon?
Yes, he's a superhero. He fights against Spaghetti Code and in his cave where he has his lab, he's working on the secret cure against the not invented here syndrome.
This is absolutely ridiculous. Where did you find the budget for this?
I made an IOU. I wrote it on a post-it note. It's in the finance system, honestly.
That explains a lot. Finance has been researching this note for weeks now.
Well, it's just that the other products, they have their fans, they have their groupies, and we don't get shit.
What would Chuck do? No.
No?
No, you're not getting the Carbon Fest. Haldur, are you crying?
No, no, it's just that I have something in my eye.
Okay, Haldur, you can have your Carbon Fest.
Really? Are you absolutely sure? You're not gonna regret this. We've been thinking about all kinds of superpowers and villains. Villains like the Feature Creep and Lord Branching. And since he's Captain Carbon, he can carbonize things. Like turning water into sparkling water and using the same powers. He can carbonize the guts of his enemies, giving them gas! Oh!
So, please welcome on stage Haldur Fannar, our CTO. Haldur.
Thanks.
Don't make me regret this.
I get my spot in the limelight. So, More people attending Carbon Fest than I anticipated. Really glad to see that you all turned out for this. I'm actually kind of surprised to see that Hilmar somehow found time to make a baby. And really how he did that with his schedule. But yeah, I'm here to talk about Carbon. Yeah, so Carbon essentially is a core technology platform, core technology for CCP. And the technology is actually created initially by harvesting code from EVE. And as you can imagine, this is code that has been developed and tested for years. So it's a pretty good code base to start with. But what we've been doing then is actually refining this code and extending it to serve the needs of the other projects that we have. And in the process of doing so, we're rolling out these changes on a regular basis within EVE. And this allows EVE to grow and evolve as a game. But at the same time, it's a great opportunity for us to actually test the changes that we're making in real stressful conditions. This process, we've actually given it a term, and we call it battle testing. And we've actually been doing this for years. Now, the Carbon logo itself, I wanted to speak to that a little bit to explain what's going on here. We didn't just pick it because we think Carbon sounds cool. We picked it because, you know, Carbon is at the core of all intelligent life on Earth. It's an amazing element. And so we find that it's very symbolic as a framework for what we're trying to achieve. Now, the logo itself also embeds a reference to the CCP logo, as you can see. But in addition to that, it's also a visualization of the server clustering that we do, which enables us to run EVE as a single shard world. And that is a commitment that the company stands strong on, and Carbon is the technology that's enabling that. And now finally, this is also how a fullerene molecule is represented, and that is the recently discovered pure form of Carbon. But I'm not going to turn this into a chemistry lesson, so let's move on. Now, you might ask yourself, okay, so how big is Carbon? What are we really talking about here? You know, is this a small little nucleus in EVE, or is it big? And as you can see, it is far from small. This is a representation where the area actually represents the number of code lines which are in Carbon versus the number of code lines that are in EVE. The code lines in EVE represent game-specific things, you know, how the spaceships behave or the UI menus that you use. But the engine code is the white piece. So as you can see, Carbon is actually more, is the majority of the code that runs EVE. Now, via Carbon, we're keeping EVE fresh. And so I wanted to speak to a couple of things that we're doing there. I mean, there's no way that I could cover everything that we do in Carbon in the amount of time that I have. So I'm going to pick out a few things. And, you know, I just want to apologize ahead of time to the people that I'm not giving a shout out here. It is simply I'm picking out things here to kind of give you an overview of what's going on underneath the hood of Carbon. So the people in the audience and the people watching on the internet that have been playing on Singularity are already familiar with the client repair tool. It's a pretty nifty technology that allows us to repair your client if something's gone wrong. We're also now starting to use this to actually upgrade the client. So it's a new patching mechanism. And that is something that we want to start rolling out on Tranquility as well. Now, rapid releases is something that you've been seeing only in the last, I would say, 4 or 5 months. There's a lot of plumbing and technology that's needed to actually enable a company of our size to do that. And that's all done via Carbon. There's a lot of processes and technology that we had to put in place so we can deploy now both fixes and new features as soon as they're done. The web gateway for experiencing EVE over HTTP. You've seen sessions on this already in the previous days. This is new technology that we're building in Carbon, and really believe that this is going to open up some really exciting possibilities for how you can experience EVE in the near future. Now, the performance analysis tools are all actually within Carbon, and the thin clients as well. This is all technology that was built within the Carbon teams. And these have actually allowed us to improve the server performance dramatically, specifically in fleet fights. So, and there's a team, Team Gridlock, that has been taking great advantage of this for EVE. And I actually wanted to give a shout out to those guys for the work that they've done and give them a hand. So, yeah. Brian Bosse, Jamie Bannister, and Daniel Pregnider. Great job. So Carbon UI is a new technology that you probably haven't even noticed. If you're playing on Singularity, we've actually rolled it out there in the first public format. It's new UI technology, new UI rendering that's going to allow us to do both UI that's more exciting, properly in 3D with all kinds of visual effects and animations. But maybe even more importantly, it is actually going to allow us to run the UI significantly faster than what we've done before. It's taking advantage of the GPUs in new and modern ways. The Carbon character technology you've seen the first glimpse of through the Carbon character creator, which is known as the EVE character creator when it's skinned. And like I said, I mean, I can't fit this in this slide, and I really don't like bullet points, so you're not going to see any more of those in my presentation. Now, I wanted to speak to a couple of things, like the environment rendering technology. And basically, how we arrive at doing these things is that we get these concept drawings from the artists, where they're trying to explain to us their vision. And these are commonly called visual targets. And they're explaining to us, OK, this is kind of the mood that I want to see. And an obvious problem with a picture like this is the number of light sources, for instance, that you're seeing there. You're seeing all these little lights all over, and those have to be represented. So we've actually created a completely new rendering path within Trinity, which is the graphics engine inside of Carbon, to support these new lighting features. There's a number of like indirect lighting, bounced lighting that you're seeing in these environments as well. And just to show you a little bit of what's going on in here, this is just a screenshot from our internal tool. So we have our own 3D editing suite. And this is showing, visualizing the different components of lighting. You're seeing the bounced lighting in one window, you're seeing the direct lighting in another, and all of this comes together then to create an environment that looks real and looks believable and looks close to what the artist actually initially envisioned. So this is the stuff that we're putting in, the sweat and the tears that we're putting in to deliver you in Karna. And here's just another visualization view from the same tool called Jessica. This is just showing the sheer amount of light sources that are going on. So it's a fully deferred rendering engine, best of breed, really competitive with the stuff that's out there. I should probably mention that Carbon is for internal consumption only. It's yours. It's just for the games that we make. So if you subscribe to a CCP game, that's how you can experience it. There's actually no way to license the technology. And my joke has been that if you want to work with Carbon, well, you just have to get a job at CCP, and we aim to keep it that way. Now, the character technology, which this is the format that you've experienced it so far, as skinned, you know, this is the kind of the EVE skin on the character creator. And it was really amazing for us to watch just the characters that got created in the first few minutes of launching this to the players. It's always amazing to see the creativity that you as players have versus the stuff that we have been doing in-house, playing around with it. And it's been said, actually, with character creation technology that a way to prove out how good it is the celebrity test. Pick a celebrity and try to recreate it with the character technology. And I think we really nailed it there. The players that made this Conan O'Brien look-alike did a great job. Now, we're rolling out even more new features. The tattooing and the scars, this is all Carbon technology that you're going to be seeing now within EVE. But I wanted to talk a little bit about stuff that's happening beyond character creation. You know, you've already seen that. What is the next step for this? So to help me talk about that, I would like to invite Ashu Rege on the stage, Senior Director of Content and Technology at NVIDIA. And we're going to show you some new and exciting stuff. So we're going to, going to be seeing a video now, which, what are we seeing here?
So what we're seeing here is actually a collaboration between our two teams. Yes. We've been working on this project for a while, and the idea is to bring more realism to the Carbon technologies that Haldor already talked about. And here we're looking at both physically simulated hair as well as clothing. And this is showing right now about, it's a mesh with about a few thousand vertices, in the character, as well as a few thousand vertices in the cloth itself. And the both you're seeing is mesh-mesh collision, as well as the cloth colliding exactly physically correctly with the rest of the environment, like the floor and so on. The other interesting feature here you're also you can notice is that the hair is also physically correctly simulated using the same technology with hundreds of vertices in the hair strands themselves. So as you can see, it's really stunning and you know, there's all kinds of physics all over the place.
Exactly. Right? And it, I mean, because one of the problems we identified immediately when we started working with these really lifelike characters was how to make them move and behave like lifelike characters.
That's right. And this, and the new Apex clothing module that we've been working on, actually, really, you guys have been our first pioneer partner, almost, which was built on top of our physics technology, is really shows off all of this, the realism that we can expect.
Exactly, because I mean, the other problem you run into is simply just a problem of man hours. Trying to hand animate the cloth and make it look believable is simply impossible. So we need to find a way to do this in real time via simulation.
That's correct.
And the question then becomes, you know, how do you do that? This must be a lot of compute instructions.
That's correct. And that's why one of the things we've been doing is basically all of the simulations are done on the GPU. Mm-hmm. And if you own a GPU that is our 8 series or above, so that was basically all the GPUs that we have launched since 2006, roughly, you can enjoy this technology.
Exactly. What happens for people that don't have a GPU like that?
Well, we also have a fallback. It will also run on the CPU. Obviously, you won't get the same degree of simulation fidelity because the CPU basically runs at anywhere between 1/4 to 1/6 of the computation horsepower that's available on the GPU.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. So what you saw just now were characters that obviously were not from EVE. These were Carbon characters, essentially. So I wanted to give you kind of a point of reference, since Incarna is going to be coming out really soon, and show you what an EVE character will look like using this technology. So what we're seeing here is actually a fully simulated robe. This robe is over 4,000 vertices. The simulation mesh is 3,000. And this is running in real time on a modern graphics card. And like Ashu mentioned, there's a fallback to the CPU if you don't have a graphics card that can support this. But then we also have an additional fallback on top of that where we animate the cloth via bones, which is the traditional old method of doing it. But you can really see here from the visuals that this is fidelity, I think, that everybody wants on their computer.
That's great.
Yeah.
And I guess one of the things we are looking at
is, I mean, scalability is the next thing for us. As you noticed in these videos, we're always showing you one character. So it's very natural to ask, so okay, so how do we deal with that?
Well, as Tony mentioned in his presentation, we are looking at basically the Moore's Law sort of syndrome, which is every year, basically, we roughly double the computational horsepower of the GPU. Mm-hmm. So really, I fully expect that in about 4 or 5 years, you'll be able to have scenes with hundreds of characters on scene in EVE and interacting and meshes colliding and simulating with each other.
And it's very important to explain this point because it's not maybe immediately obvious, but some of the stuff we do with EVE is actually very forward-looking and very strategic. We have to see where the hardware is trending, and we then have to build towards that because, you know, EVE just keeps on running. It keeps on growing. It keeps on getting better. We keep on getting more players. We have bigger fleet fights. We're going to see the same in Incarna. We're going to see more and more people. So we need to be picking technologies and solutions where we see that hardware is actually going to be supporting us throughout the year so we can actually grow as the player base grows.
And that's one reason we love collaborating with you, because you guys want to push the technology and you have sort of an environment in EU where you have essentially a really great group of players who I believe really enjoy pushing the boundaries of what they're doing, as we saw with the character creators. So we really expect some really amazing things in the future.
Exactly. Well, thank you, Ashu.
All right.
So, moving on. We have done the character creator. Images, quite amazing, looks really good. A lot of people are saying it's the best thing out there. There's nothing that can compete with this. Now, what I wanted to show you are actually the visual targets that our artists created when we initially started working out how characters in EVE would look. And so let's see if I can make this here. So this is actually a mental ray traced. This is a computer-generated picture of one of the characters in EVE. And I think what you're going to say, you know, and notice immediately is like, they don't look like this in the game right now. And the reason is that just generating one of these pictures takes over 5 minutes. And we're not going to really turn EVE into a slideshow. So this is simply not feasible today. However, what is interesting is that we can enable parts of this on the server side, because on the server side, we control the hardware, and on the server side, you're not waiting for the client to respond and do something for you. So What we are doing now is we've taken ray tracing technology from NVIDIA that actually can interoperate really well with our 3D graphics engine. And then with beefy hardware, we can actually start working towards ray tracing your characters. So I've always said that, you know, when you're pushing the envelope, you see really freakish things happening in the office. And so these are two pictures from the office. You'll see there that we started, in this case, that we're using the graphics gems book, not to kind of get algorithms out of it, but to keep all the power adapters in the power strip so they wouldn't fall out and we'd have a short. And then they took a big fan and put on top of four graphics cards just to try to cool it down so it wouldn't overheat. And when I see stuff like that, I know we're doing interesting stuff. Makes me happy. So, yeah, I want to stop the jibber-jabber and show you some of the results of what we have already. So this guy is actually ray traced through optics. And you're seeing there's a lot of small little details there, and I'm going to be going more into those. So here you can see a comparison of DirectX versus optics. And I want to draw your attention to certain areas, like around the nose and around the mouth. You'll see that in the DirectX case, we're using the typical local light approximation. So we're getting really hard shadows. The lips don't really look real because there's a really dark line going right between them. Whereas with optics, you're seeing a correct scattering of the light and thus a far more realistic shading of the of that area. Same thing goes on up here in the hair. The hair is actually self-shadowing in optics because it's all ray traced through strands. And also the hair is actually dynamically tessellated, so you don't see any angular triangles like you normally would see. And there's also some filtering that's happening in optics as well, so you don't see the aliasing pattern that you can see in the real-time DirectX hair. I have some more pictures. Here's another one. And as you can see, what I want to point out, which is quite interesting, is that from a content standpoint, there isn't any difference between these two models. These are actually the same model. We're just passing it through a different process. And what's maybe even more exciting is that to generate the optics image is taking us on the magnitude of seconds as opposed to minutes. And with the GPU roadmap that Tony was showing, it is pretty obvious where this industry is heading. So we see a lot of interesting future opportunities in rolling out even more lifelike characters for you. And here's another interesting example. These dreadlocks, currently we feel like they're not living up to the vision that we had for them in the game. But as you can see here, they're actually starting to become pretty realistic. You're seeing self-shadowing, dynamic tessellation. It's a huge difference. And of course, when you have technology like this, you have to make a bearded lady. So what you're seeing here is actually procedurally generated hair. Now, I'm hoping that Miguel can actually join me here on stage because fact of the matter is that Miguel has been working on a secret project with me, which at some point turned so secret that I'm not even allowed to see it. So I don't really know what he has, but I was hoping that he would actually share it with us.
So, I've been looking for you all week before it.
But, oh, I see.
You've been busy. Yeah. So here it is. So to recap, Tony was talking about how NVIDIA is investing in mobile technologies these days. And we have this cool chip called Tegra 2. Yeah. So this is one of the first tablets, commercial tablets available that has Tegra 2 running Android system. So I thought it would be a really cool thing to tie this with EVE, mm-hmm. since we were coming to FanFest. So let me show you what this little app I did. Yeah. Okay, let me see. Probably you will recognize some of this. Pretty cool, huh? So I was thinking maybe it would be a really interesting.
There's nothing to see here.
Yeah,
just get back in your seat.
What is this?
There was a post-it note for it.
There was?
Yeah.
It's just the fitting room for fitting window for.
But what's this device?
Oh, it's a tablet. It's a Tegra 2 power tablet.
Okay.
Is it cool? It's a really cool device.
Cool. Yeah. I actually think that Carbonfest is kind of done. I think we have to cut it short now.
You know, the cool thing is.
What?
Is I have this running on my phone as well.
Can I have that as well?
Yeah. No, take it.
Hey, it's your tail.
Awesome. Thank you, Miguel.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Calvin.
Sweet. So, Carbon, what does that really mean for EVE? Of course, having to gone through the process of taking all the technology out of EVE, turning it into this platform, battle testing it, and all these things has taken a long time. But now, really, as CCP is making more games, and CCP obviously was founded to make more games than EVE, but now EVE always benefits from all these crazy innovations which we're now doing, whether that's on the server side, the client side, or even now with mobile and all these crazy things. And it wouldn't really be possible for us to take it to this level if it weren't for the fact that this all feeds into this battle-tested platform. And it's been a little bit sort of, it's taken a long time, and God knows what, like, why does Haldur take so long to do this? And it, like, I actually figured out why it has taken such a long time. Because Haldur used to be really smart. But he's actually...
Everything will be okay. Please, Haldur, open your eyes. Open your eyes. There's so much I want to say to you. Haldur? Sweetheart? Everything's going to be okay.
Hey, kiddo.
Where am I?
You're at the hospital. You've been unconscious for quite a while.
What happened?
You don't remember.
Where's the doctor?
Welcome back, Haldur. I have the results from your blood tests, but it's not good. What you have is terminal.
Are you sure?
Your brain has been irreversibly compromised. And as it starts in your brain, it has now spread through the bloodstream and to the rest of your body. It is now only a matter of time until your brain will cease completely to function.
There has to be a treatment.
Well, this is a very rare and unusual disease. There is no cure. I think we should now be asking ourselves what we can do to make you more comfortable.
Kavi, you're not only my doctor, you're also my friend. How long?
Well, your brain is already showing signs of decay. No more than 3 days.
I can't believe it.
Well, there is a procedure. It is controversial and might be unpleasant, but if you are willing to try it out, it might be the only thing that we could do to keep you alive.
I don't think I have a choice. Go ahead.
No, I think it's obvious. The entire plan is flawed. We don't have enough resources, we don't have enough people, we don't have enough time, we don't have enough post-its. It's a technical problem, and I think the only person that can solve it is Haldur. Yao. Yeah, I heard he had some sort of operation. Apparently he had parts of his brain, all of his brain removed. Really? No, I don't believe it. I'm just going to talk to him myself. All right.
Hang on,
here's it. Haldur, we need a problem. You can perhaps help us solve it. It's a technical issue. How are you doing, by the way, Haldur? Sorry, I didn't ask. I had to have an operation. What are you doing? What are you doing?
No! No!
Yes, we hope Haldur recovers quickly and Karnbull will be done on time to deliver Incarna. Just like PRC will get through the day on Vicarine. But what about EVE and all of this? We've been talking a lot about CCP and Karpen and all these things. And of course, we had this amazing keynote which Arnar held yesterday. Arnar was recently promoted to senior producer of EVE Online, and we should all applaud him for that. And as you saw on the keynote, there's been a lot of good stuff happening already. We do promotions at CCP sort of in a special way, and I have some footage from when we were promoting Arnav.
Arnar. Will you accept this rose?
Of course.
So, Arnar is now senior producer for EVE and really controls the show there. But it was quite a running. There was a lot of people competing for the job. And there was this one guy who like had some issues with
I'm just
with not getting it.
Just really disappointed. I thought we had something going here. I put a lot of effort into this and I spent some wonderful time in the beach and bowling, dating a jacuzzi, that was... And now she... fucking bitch just dumps me like some piece of trash and... Get me out of this face.
I need to get out.
But Raki found an amazing new career on being the Don King of Iceland. He really was the guy behind chess boxing. He was the dog king behind the scenes, really making that work. I think we should give him a great applause for that. But also, while we were running chess boxing, then there was these donation numbers where people could bet on who was going to win. And we were collecting for a children's with special needs charity here in Iceland. And we actually raised 1 million ISK. And I would like to get on stage here the people from Sjónarhóll and the chess boxing team. Guys, come on. Oh, Bjossi. Don't do it, Danny. So, here we have, as you know, the CCP accounting system consists of post-its. So, Raki, if you would bring the money to the 1 million ISK. And this is the Icelandic ISK, by the way.
Well, thank you so much. Sjónarhóll supports special children and their parents towards better life, and this support would definitely help us towards that goal. So thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Another one. Applause for them. Thank you all for participating in this amazing bit that is the FanFest experience. So, Arnar, I now want to call Arnar on stage, and he's going to summarize a little bit what was going on yesterday. And also, we have later Torvi joining on to talk a little bit about the future of EVE. Arnar.
Hey guys, there's more of you than yesterday. Is he more exciting than I am? Is that the? Yeah. Yeah, okay, I know. So yesterday I did a little poll real quick on like how many people in here are hungover currently? Yeah. Yeah, so quite a bit more than yesterday. How many people drunk? Less than yesterday. Okay, you guys have some catching up to do. Anyway, I thought it was apt since, like Hilmar said, I was promoted. I'm now the senior producer. I'm responsible for this whole mess, I guess. So who am I? I'm not Jackie Chan, unfortunately, because he's really cool. I've been a player since early 2004. I joined CCP sort of as a game tester. Started testing out the game. It was fun. I was playing, then I went to testing. Same thing. It's not the same thing. And then we had an opening in game design, which I applied to and then got, and subsequently tried to nerf your carriers. This was not received very well for those of you who were around back in 2007, which is actually, I think, the occasion that picture was taken of me being choked out by Mr. Brian Haynes. It was a rather unpleasant situation. And really, from there, I moved on to sort of various production tasks. For example, I led the team that worked on the sleeper AI, meaning I've killed more of EVE players than most of you can boast of, I think. Yay for me. But really, what it is about for me is fuck yeah spaceships. And actually, could I get a fuck yeah spaceships out here? Fuck yeah spaceships! Here we go. Nice. Yesterday at the EVE keynote, I mean, we talked about a lot of things. I'm going to run through a few of them very quickly. So what's happened in the past year is, I mean, we've had even bigger battles. You heard our technical director talk about, you know, 3,000-person fleet fights that don't crash, 1,000-player fleet fights, very playable, all that. We're constantly improving on that. More activity, both in the market, in missions run, in just communications, in email sent, all of that stuff. There's a lot of buzz going. Constant intrigue. We have more and more new content. There is, you know, as you know, some things happen in EVE Online that are dramatic to many people. Alliances falling, people getting scammed. Nobody ever scams in EVE here. It's a new thing people are trying out now. In the past year, like month or so, really taking off. We're adding new content. I mean, the incursions, we've been doing a lot of sort of invigorating the life of the in-space world of EVE, and of course adding the character creator. There's a lot of new stuff and cool stuff coming in. We did, I think it was pretty cool the way our content team, and I want to give a huge shout out to them, the live team that ran the events leading up to the incursions. I hope many of you enjoyed those, so could we give them a round of applause? So that was very cool. And of course, there is so much internet spaceship drama in one year that it's impossible to go over it all. It's quite a bit. We did so much last year. There was even a microscopically measurable impact and a decline in our forum wine index. Microscopic decline in forum wine. Nobody's laughing, really, seriously. It's because you're all whining on the forums, aren't you? Just a bit. But we had our technical director and operator of Virtual Worlds talk about sort of what we're doing. Hilmar came in on that a bit, which is very cool. All this cool new hardware that we're sort of trying out, experimental stuff, very fun. And then we talked about sort of these little things in life, as Stoffer, CCP Soundwave, talked about the quality of life improvements, you know, working on improving and iterating on the game we all know and love. Getting the new UI framework out there that Halter was talking about is a huge step in that direction, actually allowing us sometime very soon in the future give you the UI that you've been seeing in trailers and that you've been asking for so long. And that's going to be amazing. The new font, not Comic Sans, unfortunately. We tried to push that through, didn't really get well done with the art department. Don't understand why. Minor laughs, yeah, okay. but in general, you saw the list, hopefully, and if you didn't, from Christopher, there's going to be a blog out soon with it. There is a huge amount of sort of smaller improvements that affect your everyday life in EVE in a very positive manner. And there's going to be a team working continuously on that in the future, sort of keeping EVE healthy and lean and mean and awesome. So leading into that, obviously, we're revamping a lot of things currently on the art side. With the new character creator leading into Incarna, obviously, that's a huge thing. But there are so many things we're doing on the art front that I really don't have time to talk about in space that are important, and then in Incarna that are important. But I am going to get Torvi Frans, creative director of EVE Online, on stage right now to give you a little insight into how the future holds, what the future holds for EVE. And this is going to be a pretty wild ride. So please welcome people and spaceships, Torvi Frans Olafsson, creative director of EVE, and futurist.
Thank you, Arthur. Thank you, Hilmar, for that great picture. You're now blocked from my Facebook account. Welcome, everybody, and thank you for coming to Iceland for this amazing FanFest. A lot of people ask me, wow, do all these people come to Iceland to meet you? I wish it were so, but I tell them, no, they come to meet each other. And then we just facilitate. And the same goes with the game itself. I mean, no one would like to play a single-player EVE, and no one would like to play EVE just against CCP employees as dungeon masters. It doesn't work that way. You are the game. Since we launched in May 2003, the game has belonged to you. It belonged to us when we were building it, but since it launched, it belongs to you. And its progress and the way it's evolved has been, of course, paid by for you, I thank you, and my salaries. But also the directions it has taken. They have not been random or stochastic. They have been forged a large part by you through various means, either through forum whining, like Arnar talked about, or through infiltrating the company as employees, and or CSM or various other means, or the FanFest. Now I want to talk to you a little bit about now. We have had a lot of discussion about our focus, like where should EVE be heading? There's a lot of forum threads about it, a lot of questions about it. Where is EVE heading? What's the main vision? Why are you always focused on this new stuff? And we have done a lot of soul searching, and we admit that we have focused a lot on new stuff for the past couple of years. But I like to look at it as a yin-yang, getting very philosophical here, that we do a balance of expansion versus iteration. That's the best way to go for now. We are expanding the game, we are growing it while iterating on it. So white represents creating new stuff, and the black, the young, is fixing the old stuff. But when we are like creating new stuff, we should always be, and this is our design like mantra, we are hooking it into and having it be part of old stuff, either like taking old systems and just completely throwing it away or refactoring them. So whatever we build, which is new, for example, Wormholes, it wasn't entirely new, it wasn't like a different game, it used a lot of elements from the existing game and thus became a much more solid feature. Also, when we are iterating on older features, it may require us to add new stuff to it. And gives us a Taoistic badassness. Just had to put that picture in there. So talking about old stuff, it's funny. This is like the discovery of Uranus, and now I'm talking about the planet that was discovered in two different places at the same time. Around the same time, we started a little website internally to create a task list for something that we called 1,000 little things. Then we realized we couldn't do 1,000, we just called them little things, which is essentially what Team Best Friends Forever is working on. And this was the entire company was pitching in a crowdsourcing fashion. Everybody could come up with an idea. Everybody could vote on it for small fixes that we needed to do to EVE. And this is how we decided to start our cycle of iteration, start on the what we call low-hanging fruit or small fixes, so that we could do a lot of them in one release, so we could do a lot of them in one sprint. And at the same time, there was a thread on the forums. There had been a number of threads on the forums, but this one was particularly popular, started by KDT, about 1,000 paper cuts, about improving EVE. And we actually, what Team Best Friends Forever, and you've heard this in other talks, they actually started with the internal thread, but then moved on to the forums. And I think it's been a great dynamic, and they've implemented a lot of things. There is, I mean, a tremendous amount of stuff that we want to and need to iterate on. And we can't do all of them at the same time. It's just impossible. But we, yeah, sign off, etc. And have to visit. It's being worked on. But it's about prioritization. We need to prioritize and make sure this is not the final list. Don't go emo-ridging. You put Starbase as number two. No, no. We need to prioritize, and we need to figure out in what order we're going to do this. And it's going to take time, and we'll only get to a couple of these, or three of these, or something like that in each release. It just takes time. But that is the journey that we are on. EVE has become so big that managing it is kind of like managing a city. You fix this road, you fix that road. There's always some fixing going on, but the entire city doesn't get fixed overnight. And the sorting is done by using a number of stakeholders. These are the people that contributed to the internal website. Of course, CSM helps us in direct dialogue with the players, but also things like the crowdsourcing, which was done on Evlopedia by CSM members and other players, and also just your input in general. We take in input from all of these different stakeholders to figure out how to sort this better. And of course, the EVE game design department weighs in very strongly, and they're actually, this is one of their major focuses right now, is like, in what order should we fix things? It's not like, how do we make new signees? It is, in what order will we fix and iterate things? Now, there are visual examples. I can talk about game systems, but there's a couple of things visually that we are iterating on. For example, the nebulas. The current nebulas, most of them were rendered back in 2002, 2003. I had a hardware friend of mine who was like a hardware buff who he overclocked his computer to like 1 gigahertz and had like 1 gigabyte of memory, and it was like super cooled, and it was always crashing, and it took days and days to render these nebulas. So this is some crazy software. Of course, things have moved on. And also, our visual style has evolved. It has become, I think, more real. And we did some experiments on our own, but we actually have good friends at Framestore, which is one of the leading, it's the biggest post-production studio in Europe, which does special effects for a large number of Hollywood blockbusters. And they have people that have worked on really big projects, for example, a recent American Museum of Natural History film and other IMAX films focusing on stars and nebula and a lot of best practices. And we have their help, and they are helping us develop the new nebulas for the game. And we're developing an entire landscape for EVE. So no longer will your nebula be determined by the modulus of the ID of your constellation, but it will be determined by where you are in space. It will be so low sec will look different than high sec will look different than zero sec will look different than Minmatar space and so on. And actually, we are designing it as such, so you can see a screenshot, you can almost see kind of where you are, which is pretty cool. And high sec is kind of warm and cuddly and cute, and then it gets kind of more like no more Mordor-esque, you know, as you move further out. And can we dim the lights? And this is not like somebody copying JPEGs of the internet and just clone stamping them together. This is rendered volumetric stuff, which takes very big computers a very long time to render, and it's amazing work. It's done in Houdini, if you're interested, but there's some matte painting involved. So, turrets have been mentioned already. We are taking out and redoing all of the turrets in-game today. We're not going to do like missile base, we're going to do them later, but we're just taking out and replacing all of the turrets. Now, I should note that in the iterative fashion that we do things, we are actually just exchanging the models themselves, the model of the turret and how it behaves, but the muscle flash will remain the same for some period, that will come out in a different iteration. It's just the way we roll. We prefer to roll these things out like in tiny bits rather than wait 5 years and wait for it to be perfect and then bring it out and have it then crash and be destroyed on your computers. So these are just some of the early concepts for the turrets. And another thing that we wanted for the turrets, we wanted them to move coolly. So they now deploy and undeploy rather than just sitting there. And they also track more beautifully. So here's a short video from that. Can we dim the lights, please? And this is just work in progress. People that only use missiles and drones. So that was the iteration part. It's an ongoing process, and your help will be much well appreciated. And now come to creating new stuff. We are now in a period of expansion for EVE. I don't see it going on forever. The past couple of years and this year and the next couple of years will involve considerable expansion of our living space, of our definition of what is the world of EVE. For a large many of years, this was basically EVE. It was hangars in space. Of course, we added stuff. We added drone regions, and we added a large number of systems inside space and services that you could access inside hangars. But you have perhaps heard us talk about the fact that we are starting to look at EVE more and more as a real thing. It's not just a cute game played by random people. It is a real world. It is a real shared world, and it's a simulation of utopia or dystopia. It depends on your point of view. My utopia. In Apocrypha, we expanded the world. We opened up a new portion of the world through wormhole space, which has different attributes, new mechanics, but they all function with the way that the world works. Then in Tyrannis, we allowed you to get an orbital view of the planets and interface with the planets. And we started with industry. We started with an industry-focused mechanic on top of the planets, but essentially what we have now is a way to interact with stuff which is on planets. This summer, we will be allowing you to step into your captain's quarters, which is kind of an operational nucleus for your pod pilot, a more visceral and more immersive setting for you to be engaged with EVE and be introduced with EVE, like Temo talked about here earlier. It's more focused towards the new player, the first iteration, and it is also a single-player environment why a single player environment in an MMO? That's really weird. No, well, again, we're going back to the iterative process. Rather than waiting 4 years, we decided to roll it out because we can roll it out at that time, figure out the issues that may come up in regards to how we render avatars, how we render environments, how they load up, and so on. But I promise you, it will make EVE more like real and more immersive for you, and also just more cool. And there's more stuff to show to your friends and your mom. Then, further on, we will be adding other station interiors. And again, this is all part of one big whole, the world that is EVE. You're just going deeper and deeper into the details. And in stations interiors, you will be interacting with the people that live inside the stations. You'll be interacting with the NPCs. I'll get to that a little bit further. But as just like wormhole space and space and the orbital view of the planets, they provide us with a platform in which we can add things and add mechanics. But our design principle is always to tie these things tightly into the rest of the game. So objects flow freely from wormhole space into space, through the hangars, into the captain's quarters, into the station interior. So an object in your station interiors is perhaps something that was manufactured on the surface of a planet in Pi and so on. And that's the beauty of EVE. It all functions in, like, no other game has this scale. And then we come to conflict on planet surfaces. Again, these conflicts will have a direct impact on things that happen in EVE, but don't worry, it's not going to be random 14-year-olds ruining your life's work. It will have a direct impact on EVE, and EVE will have a direct impact on the conflict on the surfaces of the planets, and these are going to be hooked up, and this is one shared world. That's the beauty of it. So, essentially, with the character creator, you're like tweaking skin pores and you're like picking the eye color of like an avatar. And then you have and you walk around with your avatar and you take that avatar into a massive starship. And you undock from that massive starship, from a huge station that's just next to a planet. And then you can be engaged with that planet, but not only that planet, but all the planets in that solar system. And then in your alliance, you're claiming like sovereignty for that swath of solar system and that regions. Like, what other world has this massive power of 10 size and scale to it? I find it so, maybe it's just me, but I find that cool. I want to talk a little bit about what's going to happen in establishments. These are designs where they're being thrown around. The code has not been fully implemented and checked in and tested and launched to our test server. This is stuff that we want to do for our first iteration with establishments. And establishments are the multiplayer, essentially, environments within Incarna, or within stations. And establishments are public places which everybody can visit, but they're always owned and run by corporations. And of course, you can customize them as you would like and make them like your own. And you can also put your like Corp Alliance logos or whatever. And sorry about that. and just buy random stupid stuff and put it into your establishment. Or stuff that you can find. But these are just decorative things I'm talking about here. Some of these will have game mechanical purposes, but what I've mentioned so far are decorative things. You can also rent NPCs and dress them up, which is not creepy at all, to like fit the establishment itself. And these will also have game mechanical purposes. They're not just for show, although some people will have them for their pleasure. Now, in establishments, you're gonna be able to use boosters. So we are revamping boosters. This is an example of iterations. We are going to be looking again at boosters. And the thing that we don't like about the boosters are the negative effects. So we're removing them, or reducing them considerably. So we are going to be creating a number of boosters with little or no penalties to use, but there will be other mechanics to avoid stacking and avoid you going crazy and essentially winning the game by taking too many boosters. So in the establishment, you will be able to consume mild boosters from the bar, and the person that owns the bar is the corporation, and the corporation sells these and sets the price and have to procure them and smuggle them in from low sec or zero sec. There will also be gambling, and gambling for risk or gambling for stuff, and and you can gamble away, and we think that is just cool. There's little to say more about it. Furthermore, contraband. The contraband system in-game isn't that fun. It's one of these systems that we hadn't touched for a long time, and it's very NPC-based, and the way that they scan you down, the rules around it are just not fun. So we want to change it. Again, there should be a massive disclaimer, like whenever I go on stage, like do not listen to what Torvi says. It may never come. But this is at least what we're planning to do. Contraband is not that fun, but we want it to be fun because it's what Han Solo used to do and a lot of other cool people. So we're going to start by introducing a large some number of new contraband modules and items inside the game. But in order to trade contraband, and this will be a change, you can only trade contraband person to person in HiSec. You can't trade it through like contracts or market or anything like that. You can only like have to meet person to person to trade it. But contraband is going to be something that people really want to have in HiSec, for example. However, NPCs are not going to be scanning down smugglers anymore. Players will be scanning down smugglers. And so if you scan someone down, and if he doesn't pay you your fine that you put up, you can tag him. He's a smuggler. Which player justice is just so much more fun than NPC justice. Again, this is a system we're pretty excited about. It requires some more design and iteration and testing and so on, and there are definitely loopholes which you will all exploit and and grief people. But this is essentially what we want to do. Further on, we will use the establishments as a platform to like introduce more gameplay. You will, but the tone is generally you are going into the dark underbelly of EVE. You are going offline by going out of your ship and going into stations. You're essentially going offline. The communications you have with NPCs or other players cannot be tracked or monitored by Concord or anyone. So the theme of what you are doing in stations is very kind of black market-y, shady deals, secret stuff. And furthermore, like in the far future, we'd love to walk on cities, we would like to do this. I would want to go into a sleeper site with my ship, board it with a crew, and fight the drones inside it, only to be ambushed by some assholes that were there before and successfully kill them, but then find that my ship that I left outside has been destroyed, and the only way to go home is through the barrel of my gun. That is EVE. That is our future vision. Yeah. Thank you.
How about that? Pretty exciting stuff, right? Yeah. So there's a lot of things which we're planning on EVE, as you see. And I mean, we would have to have a week-long fanfest really to go over it all. And now as we... Okay, week-long fanfest. But, might consider that for next year. But one of the challenges we have now as a company is that we made EVE back in 2003, and was a certain thing, and people have that in their heads, and now the world has moved on already and will move on even more considerably. And you, I mean, the most ardent of fans, which fly to Iceland to come to this event, We really need your help to sort of take the next level when it comes to explaining to the world really what EVE is about. Because as we all know, when we have tried to explain it, what EVE is, then, I mean, it is really difficult to explain. And it's really difficult to explain when it comes to marketing campaigns and things like that. We certainly have tried various things. This, for example, is not a really good way to explain it. And we did a sort of an internal test on, okay, could we take another way? Like, could we sort of pimp it up a little bit on the selling side? And we came up with this concept.
Hi, Henry Hayes here with another fantastic product. Have you ever been frustrated with online games which are hard to get into with a hostile, immature community? Are you tired of having to pore over confusing controls and complex game mechanics? Are you perhaps searching for that one game which is easy to get into with a helpful and friendly community? Then EVE Online is the game for you. EVE Online is the perfect game to hop into after a tiring day at work. EVE Online sports the friendliest, most helpful community of any MMO ever made. Triple money back guarantee. This children-friendly game is the perfect recreation for families. Did I say children? Yes, I said children. Even children can enjoy the ease of playing EVE Online.
Jump and hold your cloak. Primary target is Princess Beef. Thanks, Grandma. Shut up, shut up!
Order now and you will receive this exclusive eye dust hub to connect your EVE Online to Dust, an all-new exciting first-person shooter from CCP. But wait, there is more! Order today and you will receive this exclusive iDongle chat relay. You can use to connect to other Dust players and chat with them live when you meet them on the street. But wait, there is even more! Order now and you will be eligible for exclusive pre-order of World of Darkness, set to release in 2025, plus two bonus maps. But wait, there is even more! Order EVE Online now, and you will receive the exclusive soothing sensation olive oil, until now only available at certain hotel resorts. This handmade olive oil is for the first time exclusively made available with EVE Online purchases. So, order EVE Online now, and you will receive all of these exclusive items for absolutely free. Here's how to order.
Call now, 1-800-951-7713. Call now and you get the exclusive olive oil absolutely free with the iDongle and the iDust Hub. When you call, ask about our inflatable captain's chairs. Call now, 1-800-951-7713. That number again, 1-800-951-7713. Call now.
So as you see, we need some help. And we would love to get it from you. And there have been marketing roundtables over at FanFest where we've gotten a lot of good feedback because EVE really is different. And we somehow need to get that across. I mean, it is hard. I was just reading this new ISK 3.0 manual on how you make money in EVE Online. And, and I was like, oh my God, what have we created? And... So they're showing it at the store, so you can buy this online and give it to someone that needs a lot of education. But there obviously are simpler ways to get the point across. And we've been trying many sort of new approaches into thinking about what is EVE. EVE is obviously not only about spaceships flying around and blowing shit up. It is something way more, and it is something that makes people come to Iceland and put a tattoo on themselves, then it obviously isn't a game anymore. And we're really more and more started to stop thinking about EVE as a game. It is something that is just real. It's as real as the Icelandic economy is real. Which, which Maybe that's not a high bar to meet. The game that is called the Icelandic Economy is a bit smaller and uses an older version of the ISK. But there is something there, and we've certainly seen that there is something real about everything that we try to do. There's always this sort of kernel of realness. And we've been seeing these sort of pictures around FanFest, and those are sort of an idea. We're sort of putting things out there and see where it goes. Here actually is a spaceship above the FanFest venue for next year, which is the building that is the upgrade from this one. And we have gotten huge opportunities with Incarna. There are so many new things which we can do now that we have people to represent the fact that the game is really about people. The game is really about you. And I think we did a phenomenal job when it came to the PC Gamer cover in the UK. And I have quite an obsession about this Amar guy. I see him now everywhere. Like, can't stop seeing that guy. And I want to be him. But we have also... We have also these amazing creations from the community, which really inspires us and is sort of an orthogonal input into how we think about EVE. I mean, some of these things are just quite amazing. And we have sort of prepared something now, which I'm going to show, which is a bit of a vision into the future, which is really taking everything that Tori was telling you about and condensing it into one single trailer that really tries to cover all of this. And we're really now taking it all, distilling it down to this, so that we can put it out to you, you guys can give us feedback on it, and more importantly, you guys can help us to think about how do you explain this concept, which is bigger than life, because it's life itself, how do we really explain it to others? And I'm now going to play this for you. It's actually pretty amazing. It just came together just before FanFest. It's made with real-time tools. We used everything available under Carbon and all the technology that we're doing. So what you will see is basically what it will look like. It will not be like this when Incarna comes out in this year, but this is what we will do. And we would love to have you all along for it and help us really to explain all of this to the world. So here goes.
Honor isn't about making the right choices. It's about dealing with the consequences. There's a fine line between right and wrong. You'd better know which side of it you're on.
Can you take the ground station?
Not without the Corsair you promised!
You'll have it. Now keep going and do what I'm paying you for.
You just send that airstrike and the money. We'll take care of the rest.
Six, make it cover! Move up!
The moment you lose your honor, that's when you learn the hard way. Your choice always comes back around.
Okay, so I take it you like it.
Yeah!
Will you say, do you like it enough to say, fuck yeah?
Fuck yeah!
Will you say it again?
Fuck yeah!
And three times?
Fuck yeah!
Well, yeah, I guess you like it.
Play it again.
Play it again.
Fuck yeah!
Okay, you're gonna have to stand up and say fuck yeah three times if I'm supposed to play it again.
Okay.
Okay.
Fuck yeah!
I'll play it again then.
Honor isn't about making the right choices. It's about dealing with the consequences. There's a fine line between right and wrong. You'd better know which side of it you're on.
This is Bay 6. We've reached the last checkpoint before the terminus.
Can you take the ground station?
Not without the close air you promised.
You'll have it. Now keep going and do what I'm paying you for.
You just send that airstrike and the money. We'll take care of the rest.
The moment you lose your honor, that's when you learn the hard way. Your choice always comes back around.
So, I mean, all of this is because of you. I mean, it really, we would never have been able to make this game if it weren't for all of you that show so much dedication and so much inspiration to really take us to the next step and the next step. I mean, if I count up all the times that, all the minutes that all of you have logged on into the game, it's now up to almost 700,000 man years which have gone into EVE Online. And the Pyramid of Giza was made in 250,000 man years, so we have almost made three. And obviously, the subscriptions help a lot, so thanks for those. But really, it is this. It's really you have constantly challenged us to take it even further, whether it is through the CSM or through just the amazing amount of emerging gameplay that goes on in EVE. And it's really that that allows us to come up with these crazy concepts and the crazy ideas, powered by hardware from NVIDIA and IBM and all the partners we have around that. That really is, it really all comes from you. So I really need your help now to get this video out there. It will go up on YouTube. So if you could post it to Facebook and Twitter a little bit about it, if you like it, and sort of try to help us explain to the world what really is going on here, because it's really difficult to get the concept across. So thank you all for coming. Thank you.